Today on Larry King Now, one of Nashville's finest, Dierks Bentley.
I can't describe the feeling, but it's just like everything, just like stars aligning. It was just like, boom, this is what I'm supposed to do with my life.
Let's talk about some of the singers you've toured with and played with. Kenny Chesney.
One of the nicest guys on the road. Bought me a boat at the end of a tour as a present to say thank you.
Can you still make it in Nashville?
It's hard. I think it's harder than it's ever been.
Plus.
I love bluegrass music, yeah. It's my favorite.
Really?
Yeah, it's my favorite. It really is my favorite genre of music. I feel like bluegrass should be legalized.
That's all ahead on Larry King Now. Welcome to Larry King Now. I recently sat down with country music star Dierks Bentley at the Cinefamily Theater in Hollywood. The Grammy-nominated singer was in town to promote his new album, Riser, which is out today, February 25th. In conjunction with his new music, Dierks has also released a documentary titled Dierks Bentley, Riser, now available on demand at cmt.com. His first ever headlining tour starts this May. Dierks' album is called Riser, right?
Yes, it is.
Meaning?
Risen? Yeah, I'm rising up. Well, you know, it means a lot of things for me, this record. My dad passed away about a year and a half ago, and that was the start of the recording process. And at the end, my son was born, so it's kind of been a rise of emotions for me, from kind of grief to gratitude. And in that particular song, it's just about a person that no matter how many times they get knocked down, they keep rising back up. So love the song, and I feel like the song and the message kind of reflected my personal life over the last 2 years.
Close with your father?
Yeah, real close. You know, I left home at an early age, but he was quite a bit older than he was 51 when I was born, and fought in World War II. I mean, he's just part of that great generation of men, and real close, although I've been living away from Arizona for a long time, but a lot of memories growing up together and doing things together, and yeah, real close.
Got to see his grandson?
He saw his two granddaughters, but he didn't meet. Knox came about a year after he passed away. But and my brother Bart, he has three girls, so this is the first boy of in the family. But my sister has a son, so he knew the lineage was being passed on.
How did you get the name Dierks?
Great question. It's my mom's side of the family. People often think that's like a stage name. Like, I actually chose Dierks, which is like,
it's kind of hip.
If I was going to choose a name for country music, it'd be like Buck Bentley or something.
If I was starting over, I'd be Dierks King.
Hey, it's a great name.
It's a nice name.
It's a last name on my mom's side of the family that was given to me as a first name. So it's a family name.
So, yeah. And now, what's the significance of this song, I Hold On?
Well, I started writing that song after my dad passed away. I was thinking about the road trip we took from Phoenix to Nashville. When I was 19 years old, we drove out there together to start the stream, and we drove out there in a 1994 Chevy truck. And I was wondering, why do I still drive that same truck? I could long ago bought a new one. I've been offered free trucks too, and I still drive that same truck because of memories like that. You know, I mean, when I drive it now, I still think about looking over and seeing him riding, you know, sitting in the shotgun. And so I just kind of hold on to things that mean something to me.
Do you intend to hold on to things?
It's not a lot of things, but just the things that I've had. That one truck, I have one guitar that I play a lot of that's I've worn out. And so, I used to, like, and only in country music can you use the analogy of a truck and a guitar to relate that as a love song to your wife. But that's what I kind of did on this song. You know, I hold on to this truck, I hold on to this guitar, so I'm going to hold on to you. It's only in country music does that work. It doesn't work in other genres.
When did you know you wanted to be a professional singer?
I guess it'd be 17. I always loved music. I was always singing and trying out different types of music with my voice. But at 17, I heard Hank Williams Jr. sing. Someone played a song of his for me, and it just, I knew I'd found my home. I can't describe the feeling, but just like everything, just like stars aligning. It was just like, boom, this is what I'm supposed to do with my life. And I moved to Nashville 2 years later.
Is on tour Dierks the same as he was 5 or 10 years ago? Have you changed?
I think I've evolved, you know, as a performer on stage. I feel like myself and the band are better than ever. I feel like we're really free, and there's just a lot of movement and interaction with the crowd, and a real sense of togetherness from the live show. And on tour, Dierks backstage still likes to have a few drinks and hang out with the guys and cut loose. Hangovers hurt a lot more than they used to, and I try to avoid them as much as possible, but some nights it's unavoidable.
Do you like performing in front of an audience as much as recording?
I love being on stage with the band in the live show. I actually enjoy recording now more than I used to. I used to look at records as kind of fuel for the tour. And now I look at records as like, almost like a piece of, like a great book or something that you want to have around for all time. And not that, you know, I've always put as much as I can into my records. They've always been snapshots of my life, but I just have a lot more respect now for the fact these things are gonna be around forever, and I want them to be as good as they possibly can be. So, but I love being on stage and being in front of my fans, and that interaction is the best.
Have you duetted too? Do you work with
them? I have. I had a chance to record some songs with people I really, really love. On the Bluegrass record I did not too long ago, I had Miranda Lambert and Jamie Johnson on a track together, so the three of us. That was probably one of my highlights I've ever done of a
You sing recording. Bluegrass too?
I love bluegrass music, yeah. It's my favorite.
Really?
Yeah, it's my favorite. Really, is my favorite genre of music. I mean, bluegrass to me and country are—it's bluegrass falls in the country, under the country umbrella. I feel like bluegrass should be legalized. It gets kind of pushed to the side, but
is it the bastardized version of country?
To me, it's the most. I just find it to be the most authentic genre of music. Just the instruments, you know, these instruments that don't require amplification. You know, banjo, mandolin, dobro, and a fiddle. And you trace how those instruments came to our, you know, this country from different places, from you know, from Ireland and Sweden to Africa. You know,
the history,
and it all came together in a very American way to make this sound. You know, that Bill Monroe is responsible for, and guys like Ralph Stanley and Flat Scruggs as well too. So,
it's included in all your concerts.
My shows have a lot of banjo, a lot of dobro, a lot of fiddle, but we, you know. I have different concerts for different, you know, times in my life. Right now, we're headlining all the major amphitheaters, and it's about as loud as we can legally get away with. You know, the guitars are to 11.
We're going to see a clip from the documentary.
Okay, cool.
But first, what was your break? Did you have a big break?
Yeah, it was my break kind of came in waves, I guess. Just my main thing was just playing anywhere and everywhere that I possibly could, and. One of the guys I was playing with, our drummer, happened to work in the tape library for a publishing house. His job was to put together different songs on a cassette so that a song plugger could go take that to Tim McGraw and try to get Tim McGraw to cut a song. So he knew people, and he helped me make some contacts. And then a guy named Arturo Buenahora kind of took me under his wing and put me together with a guy named Brett Beavers, and we produced my first record. So it's just different people along the way have kind of come into my life and helped me out.
After the break, Dierks is living the dream. We'll go back to where it all started. Stay with us.
I want this album to sum up just who I am as a guy going through these different changes in life that happen when you lose your dad and you get married and you have kids, but you're still on the road rocking and playing video games and acting like you're 13 years old on stage with a guitar in your hand. And
two phrases, touring musician and family man, were never meant to go hand in hand. It's just two loves of your life are pulling at you, your family and the love of music.
Well, just like writing a song is editing it all down into a story, into a book that has chapters that really sum up who you are. And when you read all those chapters together, man, I know exactly who this guy is. I'm kind of writing it to figure out exactly who I am as well.
That was a clip from Dierks Bentley's new documentary, Dierks Bentley Riser. Now more of my recent conversation with the country star. Tell me a story about this documentary. Not many country singers do self-documentaries.
Yeah, well, it's not something I really wanted to do. it was someone's idea in my camp, and the more I thought about it, though, I was like, you know what, if I wanted to make a home movie of any time in my life, now would be the time, because our music and career and our touring's firing on all eight cylinders. You know, we're just rocking. And at the same time, I have this, you know, family and three kids, and they're young, and it's just crazy right now at home. So it's the perfect, like, storm of, like, you know, things.
We see everything in the documentary?
Yeah, it's the cameras kind of go from the stage to the bus to my house to there's footage in the delivery room before my son was
really?
Born. Yeah, it's pretty... I was going to say the word uncomfortable, but I kind of squirm when I think about it a little bit.
Do we see the delivery?
That's the long unrated version. We're going to have that come out in the fall. You know, we're trying to save something for trying to get
Do we see you change diapers?
That's the easy part of being a dad, but I think I might change a few diapers in there. I'm not sure. But it's just touring and the love of music and that being my first love, and then family and trying to be really great at both these two different completely separate things. And it's a lot about what I write about is just that mixture, and that makes it on the record, and certainly the documentary visualizes all of it.
You write all your own songs?
I write a lot of my own music. I think I had a stretch there on country radio where I had about 17 songs in a row that I wrote. and that wasn't by choice. I've always tried to look for great outside songs. I just kind of am a songwriter first and foremost. But on this record, I really, really wanted to hear every song that Nashville was writing. And my friend Arturo, he was the executive producer. He just brought me some great songs. The song Riser, I did not write that song. It's one of the best songs I've ever heard. So this record's really a split between the stuff that I wrote and the stuff that I found in Nashville. And I'm really proud of that, because I think one of the things that sets Nashville apart is the songwriters. You know, we have a great community of songwriters. And you know, those guys are my friends, and I see them everywhere, and I want to include them in my work. And so I was really able to do that in this record.
You always record there?
No, I've recorded in Brooklyn.
Brooklyn?
Yeah, recorded in Brooklyn. About 3 years ago, I kind of just stepped away, or I guess about 4 years ago, just stepped away from the whole country music machine and just just unplugged for a little bit. And I made this bluegrass record called Up on the Ridge, and recorded some of that with this band called the Punch Brothers. Chris Thiele is probably the most recognizable figure of that band. He's with a band called Nickel Creek. But they work out of Brooklyn, so I went up there and cut some songs
My
with them.
Hometown.
Yeah, it's great. It was a great place to play some music. I could see the Statue of Liberty outside of the through the windows of my vocal booth. It was pretty inspiring.
Unlike most country singers, maybe all country singers, you graduated from the Harvard of the South.
Yes, I did.
Or as Vanderbilt calls itself.
Yes.
You call Harvard the Vanderbilt of the North.
Gotcha,
right?
Gotcha.
What'd you major in?
English.
Now, not many country singers go through Vanderbilt.
Yeah.
One of the great schools in the country.
Yeah, it was kind of my way of getting out. My way of getting to Nashville was, when I was 17, I knew what I wanted to do. I didn't have the chops yet to do it. I was writing songs. I moved to town at 19, I had like 10 songs written. You know, I had them in like in a plastic binder. I thought they were like these are my best 10 songs. And I got there, and you know, thank God I had school, because I needed those 4 years to really continue to hone the craft.
What was your grade point average to get in?
I never had above a 3.0 when I was in college.
But you got into Vanderbilt?
I got in, yeah. I had some help. Actually, the guy that turned me on to country music, Jack Brown, he was like, his dad had gone there and his grandfather had gone there. So when he went down there, I kind of followed him down there and had a little help getting in. But
tough school.
Yeah, and I did terrible, and I never even walked across the stage for graduation, and I couldn't tell you where my diploma was. I mean, I went there strictly for country music. The day I got to Nashville, I went to the Country Music Association and got an internship right away, day one. I mean, I hit the ground going to every honky-tonk, every writer's night, and thank God I had school to kind of camouflage those early years of learning, because I had a lot to work on.
When we return, Dierks is headed back to the stage. He'll tell us what we can expect from his summer headlining tour right after this. Welcome back. This summer, Dierks is embarking on his first ever headlining tour. Here's what he had to say about it. This summer, you'll be headlining your first ever tour.
Yes.
Where are you going?
Gosh, man, we're going everywhere. I mean, we're playing all these amphitheaters that I've played in the past. I've usually been there as an opening act, or last year as a co-headlining tour with Miranda Lambert. This is our first year kind of fully taking off the training wheels and getting a chance to do it on our own as a headliner. So it's just amphitheaters all across the country where people
one
come.
One night to another night to
mm-hmm, yeah.
Bus or plane?
Well, I do have my pilot's license, so I do fly from time to time, but mostly on a bus. But I fly a little plane called a Cirrus. It's a 5-passenger prop plane, single engine, parachute built into the airframe in case the engine goes out. the whole plane comes down under canopy. But
You're kidding, right?
No, I'm dead serious, yeah.
The plane is a parachute.
We're dead serious, but I'm serious, yes. Yeah, the plane actually comes down under a canopy, yeah.
Why can't every plane have that?
Exactly.
I think would cure all accidents forever.
There's been a lot of talk about it, being in commercial airliners, but it's a great plane, and it's awesome because I can't afford to fly in the back of a private jet, you know, but I found out I could afford to get my pilot's license and sit in the front left seat of a prop
plane. Have you ever come down by parachute?
Not yet, and I don't want to find out about it. Right. Is that wood? That's not. This is wood, okay.
Let's talk about some of the singers you've toured with and played with. Miranda Lambert.
Awesome. I mean, just love her. She's never changed. She's just a fighter. She's out there, you know, in a lot of ways, which is, you know, this guy's world of touring, and it's tough out there. And she just puts her fists up every day and goes out there and gets it done. She's great.
Gary Allen.
great dude, makes really good music. I think he's always put a premium on good songs and good records, and got a great voice, and I like him a lot.
Kenny Chesney.
Done two tours with Kenny. I mean, one of the nicest guys on the road. Bought me a boat at the end of a tour as a present to say thank you, so I can say nothing wrong with Kenny.
A boat?
He gave me a boat. I walked off my bus and at the end of this tour, and there's a sea ray sitting there, a 20-foot sea ray, and I go, kind of slapping him. I was like, good job, Kenny, congratulations, you know, buying yourself a boat. And he goes, no, that's for you. And we climbed all over the boat, and then when I was done, he said, all right, take it back to Nashville. He drove it up to Indianapolis just so I could see it, and they drove it back down to Nashville.
Brad Paisley.
Good friend. Been on tour with Brad a bunch, too. Probably one of the most, you know, amazing guitar players we have in country music. His dexterity is just unbelievable, what he can do on the guitar. Never misses a note. And great guy.
You a good player?
No, I play good enough to sing, too. And I'm always a student of it. I'm always trying to get better. But a guy like Brad Paisley's in a whole other dimension.
Carrie Underwood.
I mean, probably one of the best singers in town. I mean, her and she's got one of those voices. It's just like, you know, Mike Martina, just this huge voice that comes out of such a small person. And I had a chance to tour with her some, too. And big fan of her husband, Mike Fisher, great hockey player.
Sugarland.
Great people. I've toured with them as well. Christian couldn't be nicer. Jennifer Nettles is like...
Anybody you don't like?
I'm one of those guys that kind of know... I'm like the kid in high school that kind of got along with everybody. I keep asking me. Maybe we'll find someone, but Jennifer Nettles could be nicer.
Garth Brooks, who I've known a long
time.
Hero
of mine. Garth is one of the reasons I got into country music. The first concert I saw was Garth.
He said country fans are the best fans. Mm. You agree?
Without a doubt.
And country stars usually never get above it, right? They're always down home.
If they get above it, they kind of just get knocked off pretty quick, I think. Don't get above your raisin. Great Flat and Scruggs song. Garth is, everyone has a Garth story. You probably have 100 of them, but my first country concert, my first concert was Bon Jovi and Skid Row. But my first country concert was Garth Brooks. And I felt like he was singing right to me. You know, there's no video screens, no moving lights. I was with my brother. My seat was so high up in the arena, I could touch the roof. I had like the worst seat in the building. And I felt like he was singing right to me. Yeah.
Bon Jovi did country?
No, that was my first concert. I was 13 years old, and I went to go see Bon Jovi and Skid Row. So it was a rock show. And I spent the whole time looking at a girl next to me wearing a black leather dress. And I've told John that, and he goes, that's a sign of a good concert.
There's been some criticism of your friend Blake Shelton.
Yeah.
Yeah, of that he, you know, he's a star of a television show.
Oh.
That he's gone maybe mainstream.
Yeah.
Do you buy any of that?
I haven't heard it, and I definitely wouldn't buy into it because I know Blake personally, and I think what he's doing is great. I think he was made to do what he's doing. I don't think there's anyone in country music that has the charisma and the
You were
wit.
On our show together with him. On
yeah,
CNN.
Yeah, yeah.
You were
I was looking at that picture. Is you, is yourself, myself, John Rich, and Blake Shelton. Who would have thought that Blake would be in everyone's living room?
I mean, yeah, wow.
But I don't think there's anyone. He does it. He's so good at it, and I think he's. I'll tell you something about that. And that's true. We had that night. Me, John Rich, and Blake. I mean, they're all such honky tonkers at heart and love traditional country music. That you could never, no matter how far Blake bends or does other stuff, the guy really loves country music.
Martina McBride was on recently. We talked about the acceptance of the gay community in country music.
Mm.
Do you think that could happen? Could there be a country star who comes out?
I don't know. That's a good question about a star. I know in the community in Nashville, I mean, it's, you know, I have a lot of friends that are, you know, gay, straight. There's all sorts of people in Nashville writing these songs and in the industry and in the music.
You know gays that are writing country songs, singing?
Of course. I don't know any artists, but
well, it's regardless
maybe,
I don't know. Redneck country, and usually that we have the, maybe a stereotype that rednecks
Nashville is, I mean, I think people come to Nashville, it's kind of a good thing and a bad thing, too, but people are just discovering my little city. After being there for 20 years, it's just blowing up because people are realizing that it's just such a great town. It's not any stereotypes they might have about it or country music, I think, are immediately shot down the second they get to Nashville because it's such a, it really is a such a mixture of people. It's and such a great community.
After the break, Dierks takes your questions. Stay with us. We're back with country star Dierks Bentley as he answers some of your questions. Check it out.
Is there a different country sound now? Does country sound change?
Country sound changes every year. Always has. It's never been the same.
What's the current sound?
The current sound's a mixture of what the people making it grew up listening to. The people we look at as traditionalists, you know, George Jones and Merle Haggard constantly get thrown under this bus, but it's like they were never traditionalists. They were pioneers. You know, they were using sounds that no one had used before, and Johnny Cash was using trumpets, and Haggard was using saxophones. You know, they were pushing the boundaries and doing different things. And, you know, I'm looking over this picture of the wall, a guy looks like Ray Price. You know, Ray Price is one of our great traditional country singers, but on Here for the Good Times, he had strings and these lush arrangements. Everyone's always pushing the boundary. Now it's just, you know, it's just expanded. You have country rock, country pop, country Disney,
country
hip-hop.
Disney?
I mean, there's songs that cater to the, you know, these 11, 12, yeah, 8, 9, 10, 11-year-old kids who listen to country music. When I was growing up...
Sounds funny to me. I don't know why.
Yeah, well, when I was growing up, you know, Alabama was singing, 40-hour week. It was more of a working person's type of music, but... It's funny about Alabama. My 5-year-old has an Alabama, we have a record player, and she has the same vinyl. I was listening to it on like a CD. She has the vinyl Alabama Greatest Hits, and I'll walk by her room and she's listening she's listening to 40-hour week. She's listening to Dolly Parton 9 to 5. It's like, so, I don't know. Country music has a way of just going through all ages, but
we're in the silent movie theater in the Hollywood district, and they're gonna show you a documentary here, right?
Hopefully
I see your name out front.
Hopefully there's gonna be sound.
can you still make it in Nashville?
It's hard. I think it's harder than it's ever been. You know, it was a town where you could move, when I moved there, with a guitar and go to the writers' nights, go to the honky-tonks, hopefully someone comes out and sees you at the Bluebird, sees you at a bar. Now, I think you have to be so much more savvy with your socials and you're getting a following and generating internet buzz and obviously The Voice and The Idol, American Idol, that's a whole other segment you have to compete against as a person with a guitar.
What's the record sales? What is all
and
iTunes?
Sales are down, so that's one way of looking at it. On the flip side, you've got this whole new generation of singers and songwriters that are so scrappy. I mean, it's the guy that produced my record, Ross Copperman, he can write a song, he can play a guitar, he can play the Pro Tools and the computer and create a track, and you walk out the door after writing a song. Usually I walk out the door with a song on my iPhone, you know, recorded with two acoustic guitars. When I leave Ross's house, I have a CD of a fully composed song, you know.
Wow.
It's just unbelievable what they can do.
My wife had an album. You had the same producer,
I know,
right?
Sean, yeah. We have both had Luke Wooten both produce our records.
How good is he?
Luke is great. He's got a great ear. He can do acoustic music so well. He can do rock, heavier country music so well. He really gets great vocals. And the big thing about a producer is just being that comforting voice of confidence and never getting rattled. And
how important is the producer?
Oh, that relationship with the producers is everything, you know, because... You're going out, you're creating, what's great about music is you're creating something out of nothing.
I mean, you're the director of a movie.
Yeah, you have nothing. We got a pen and paper. We're gonna turn nothing into something that becomes woven into the fabric of people's lives. Here we go. You know, you're going off this journey together. So it's a marriage in a lot of ways.
Before we get some questions from social media, what got you interested in flying?
I loved flying early on, but I ran out of money and time to continue it. But then when my kids came along, I realized I needed to spend more time at home, and I was trying to find ways to get to be there, and I can't afford to be in some private plane. So, you know, my A-list are on Southwest, but Southwest doesn't fly to all the small towns I play, so this new plane came along called a Cirrus. Tim McGraw was flying it. I looked into it, loved the parachute idea. Realized I could get to most of my places in 2 hours, so.
Couple of quick questions. Lex King on 8 via Twitter. What's the concept of your new song, Drunk on a Plane?
The concept is just a fun story about a guy who gets stood up at a proposal at a wedding, but he still has the tickets to go to Cancun. He can't get his money back, so he goes on this plane and gets drunk, and you can take it from there.
Will you ever do another M. Warner on one on Instagram? Wants to know if you'll ever do another bluegrass album.
I will. The first record is called Up on the Ridge, and we'll definitely have another one coming out here somewhere down the road, maybe called Down in the Holler. I'm not sure.
Bryson Knox on Facebook. What's your favorite song to sing at concerts?
What are the latest singles? Right now, probably I Hold On.
And finally... Dierks, you have to go back to your memory here.
Okay.
The first girl you ever kissed.
Oh, gosh. It's either Aaron Timmerman or Lindsay Piccinotti. I'm not sure.
One or the other.
Yeah, I can't remember.
Aaron Timmerman, do you know what happened to them?
I think they're both married and doing great.
How old were you?
I'm 39.
How old were they? I mean, when you kissed them.
No. fourth grade? I don't know.
Nashville?
Phoenix. Yeah.
Hey, Dierks, this is great.
It's an honor, real honor. Thank you so much, Larry.
My pleasure. Thanks to my guest, Dierks Bentley, and make sure you pick up his new album, Riser, available now, and catch his documentary, Dierks Bentley Riser, on demand at cmt.com. The Riser Summer Tour starts in May. As always, find me on Twitter at KingsThings. See you next time.